Hi, welcome to another episode of ComSpeak. Today, our guest is Shivani Gupta. Shivani is the founder and managing director of SPAG and The Yellow Elephant. In the next few minutes, we'll learn more about Shivani's professional journey, her career, and things she has done to stand out in this cluttered world of public relations. Welcome, Shivani, and thanks for joining us on ComSpeak.
Thank you so much, Amit. It's a pleasure to be here.
Glad to have you. As we do with all our guests, our first question is to ask them how they got into the profession. So tell us about how you got into public relations, Shivani.
Okay, so now I started my post-graduation with NIA, National Institute of Advertising. And of course, I entered the institute with the whole idea of understanding the mass comm. My bent of mind was more towards advertising, but I think the first semester, first session, PR class, and I was completely floored. So I think that was the first day when learned about what PR is, learned about how the case studies were taught to us. I think that was the time I decided this is where I'm going to go.
Interesting. And then after your program, you joined a PR firm. Tell us how that happened. Was it a campus placement? Did you apply for a job? Or did somebody who worked there know you and asked to join them? Tell us that story.
So yes, campus placement, definitely. And of course, I did a lot of internships during my 2 year post-graduation. But yeah, the first job, official first job was Perfect Relations is the concern, of course, which was Imprimis. And it just happened. I never intended to join healthcare comms. But it sounded interesting. It sounded more like, you know, purpose driven, more which made sense to me. And I think that was something fantastic that happened to me. And I just kind of jumped on it.
Interesting. So you spent a few years at Perfect Relations, then did a stint in corporate communications as well. Tell us about that.
So a few years in Perfect Relations. And of course, from there, I was hired by my ex-client, of course, which was Becton Dickinson, and which was again a very interesting, you know, in the whole corporate sector, BD was completely male dominated at that point in time, and more from the Copcom side of it. And I was the only Copcom person hired there for one particular, division. So yeah, I worked closely with the senior business leaders, worked closely the initial years of my career. It was quite a proud feeling, and of course, work closely with the CEO of the organization. And I was involved not just in the corporate communication part of it, you know, I was pulled into the marketing team as well. So I guess it was a big opportunity for me. And again, there was a panel made for the marketing team. So that is where I had worked on right from the website to the corporate communication plans, to the PR, everything. It was completely on my own when that happened.
Interesting. So you spent almost 2 decades in the world of public relations after your studies, initially in PR consulting, then in Corpcom. And then a few years later, you started SPAG. Tell us what went about in the planning to start off your own PR firm.
So after BD, of course, there was another shift, which was corporate research services. And post that, during that time, of course, I had my baby. And during that time, I started doing my freelance work and taking care of the baby. And also, we started PR in India, which was more like a, you know, media network, the largest media network in the country. So I think that is, again, one interesting work that we did, which was like reaching out to 150 cities during that point in time. Not anybody was doing that, which was the largest network. And I started working on that. PR in India was, at the very initial stages. From PR in India, the whole re-christening happened to SPAG. And SPAG happened, of course, the registration of the organization happened much before the organization happened. Because I think Aman and I coming from the same background, we always had this in mind that we're going to have, an organization in healthcare comms. And so, it happened from SPAG, which is like a strategic partners group. Yeah, it was earlier more with the initials of our family, which is like me and Aman and our son Pratham. Yeah, but it came out to strategic partners group later.
Nice. No, nicely done. And you mentioned healthcare. So tell us a couple of things about the healthcare communication space, because that's a very, very interesting space across the world. There's a great demand for talent in the healthcare comm space, but not too many people are easily able to cope with the demands of that space. So my first question is, what are the biggest challenges you foresee for PR firms or communicators in the healthcare space? That's one. And I'll ask you my next question after I hear you out on this one.
So, yeah, definitely healthcare space in terms of regulatories and in terms of understanding the compliances, there are a lot of things, and it's definitely not a, you know, glamorous thing. And a lot of reading, you need to be very cognizant of the policies, you need to be well-read on the terms, and you need to be well-read on what you're working on, the message. And of course, it's very social, message-driven. So the responsibility definitely, you know, is an added responsibility to be a healthcare communication professional. And yeah, that is something which people are little, you know, I don't see. I see a lot of millennials and Gen Z, this generation now, really working towards, wanting to work towards something which is more purpose-driven, which is like giving back to the society, which is more like a social message. I think whenever I am interviewing for people who are like from various backgrounds, they have left a couple of such backgrounds very glamorous, and why they want to do healthcare communication intrigues me, you know. It's more because, you know, we something bad happened or something they have written about, they have gone through. It's more like now they would want to do, they would want to learn and come back to society. I think that's really important. And if somebody with that kind of passion wants to come, and that kind of objective wants to join the sector, I think there are, it's no looking back there.
Right. So, I mean, the sector has its own challenges, but the opportunities are immense in the healthcare communication space. And we are seeing that there are a lot of smaller firms emerging and making their mark in the healthcare communication space. But I think in the last 5-6 years, you've established yourself as a leader in the healthcare advocacy communication space and done that with great aplomb, and kudos to you all for doing that. Here's a question that I keep asking sometimes partners who are partners in real life as well as in the workplace. How is it like to be working as a business partner to the man you're married to? How do you manage and navigate that? Tell us about that, because there are many such couples in the world of PR and communications who are married to each other and also partners in the workplace. Just throw some light on how you navigate that space.
I think there are always pros and cons to everything. So like if you're in the same field, same sector, you understand the challenges. You know, if your spouse is working 12 hours, 16 hours, 18 hours a day, you know why that person is working, you know, and you understand the... So conversations, yes, conversations do happen at the work table, at the dinner table, you know, conversations do happen while morning coffees or something. And then even on the weekends, but yeah, we try to restrict, okay, now we don't want to talk. Let's just kind of, you know, leave this banda to something else and think about something else. But I think during those conversations, some interesting ideas also come up. Yeah. And there are some interesting, and it's also the kind of push and the encouragement we can give to each other with those ideas and with those thought processes, because it's in one direction. And even if we are trying to kind of, be the devil's advocate, that also helps, you know, because at the same place, you know, over a drink or over a coffee, you're trying to evaluate the situation. You're trying to think on ideas. You're trying to create new things. And it happens over these. Actually, I think COVID times happen during this time. The conversations happen more for coffees and drinks and lunches and dinners.
Right. Oh, it's interesting. I'm going to spend the next few moments or minutes on a couple of campaign-related questions. My first one is, name that one communication campaign in your 2 decades of working career, both employed somewhere else and in your own business, that one communication campaign that stood out for you and you felt, wow, that's the campaign that's always been memorable and you're proud of working on.
So there have been many such campaigns when we started working, because healthcare, like I said, has... I didn't want to start with it, but yeah, when I started, got into it, it's been like all the campaigns, whether it was, you know, any social media campaign, any social impact campaign has been very close to my heart. All my campaigns, all our campaigns are being, like, kind of devised one part over the other. But the one campaign which is of course not the campaign, and I would say like I think that I wanted to talk about, I have been talking about it. In Kotex, when they launched the sanitary napkins, and it was more about, not the blue stain that they wanted to show. It was more about how the red blood, actually the blood looking like liquid they used for the campaign. So, which is something, those kind of campaigns, the message driven, which kind of become the movement, and there is, no stigma attached to it. They are trying to work. Those are the campaigns.
What was that campaign called? That people listening to this show can go look online and find more about the campaign. What was that campaign called?
It was in Kotex. Kotex sanitary napkins.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the brand name, but if there's a name for the campaign, it'll help. But I'm sure people will figure out if they're right.
Campaign name, yeah.
Fair enough. Is there a campaign that you really were passionate about and worked on it? Giving your heart, mind, and soul, and it didn't really work out the way you wanted. The results were not as per your expectation. Is there one campaign like that you feel was an amazing campaign that you really thought it was going to go places, but it did not for whatever reason? And what's your learning from that, if there was one like that?
Okay, so off late, honestly, again, there is no such campaign. But off late, we have been discussing amongst ourselves that during this pandemic time, what we really wanted, what would really be nice, is that if we change communication, if we could have engaged with the right relevant stakeholders and partner with maybe the government or maybe the relevant stakeholders. So there is a behavior, there is a lot of opportunity which we thought we could have done in terms of bringing that behavioral change amongst the people, whether it was a COVID appropriate behavior. So you talk about the diagnostics which people are avoiding right now, because of the COVID times, people are trying to, whether it's the diabetes, whether it's the heart-related issues, whether it's anything which they are trying to avoid not going to the doctor. So there is a lot of, integration that, and a lot of communication, right message that can be sent to people, that can be through different campaigns, through different messaging and right storytelling. How technology can help and how these things are equally important, probably more important than, battling this pandemic right now. Because pandemic might say through that, but this is something which could be a long run issue. So those are the things which are not being talked about, and which is what, we always confess that this is something we really, really want to work on.
No, thanks. Fair enough. I'm going to now move away from talking of campaigns and work. We know you for a couple of reasons beyond work, and I'll bring that up during our conversation. But I hope this question will help you answer that. What do you do to unwind? And tell us about that part of you, which some of us know because of your Instagram feed. And maybe there are things you do beyond Instagram that we see on that you do to unwind. So tell us about how does Shivani Gupta unwind from a busy day of work at office and at home?
Okay, so I'm, I would say, a yoga practitioner, and I don't like calling myself yoga, but yeah, the social media world is intense. It's more like yoga addict and yoga practitioner. So that is something that helps me unwind, which helps me, I think it's more about inner awareness. It's more about it takes care of my physical and mental health. I think that's the time of the day. It's just me and my focus is I'm at. It's only, nothing else. It's a very mindful practice, which I love doing. That is something that I have been practicing since many years, and I wish to continue that. And I have been doing a lot of workshops apart from that. And apart from that, COVID times, pandemic has made all of us big shifts, I think, big all shifts, whatever. So I started doing it, and which is again a stress buster for me, maybe on the weekends. So that is something that I have been doing.
So you do yoga at one end, and then you do stuff around foods and calories and eating on the other end, which is great. And I've always known of you in the last 5-6 years. I've known you to be a fitness conscious person. That's great and inspiring. For those watching this show, you should check out Shivani Gupta Yoga. I think that's the Instagram handle, right? It's inspiring. When I feel I need some fitness goals to be made and I need inspiration, I look at Shivani's yoga poses and postures and little videos on Instagram and make me feel like, wow, I need to get fitter by just looking at the emphasis Shivani puts into that aspect of life. I'm going to move out of the personal back to the work questions again. A lot of younger people wanting and aspiring to get into the workplace in the world of PR, and we'll come to a message you have for them a little later. But what is the one thing you have learned as an entrepreneur in the last 5 years and otherwise from younger colleagues? What is it that you've learned from younger colleagues that stands out for you? Just share some ideas and thoughts on that.
That's a very interesting question. Actually, I have been discussing this with my younger teammates and colleagues, you know, like I said, I mean, I know that there is some pressure we guys put on whole, you know, like as organizations probably, or, you know, the kind of work, everything we are doing. But I think the amount of pressure the millennials and Gen Z put on us is on how to evaluate, and how to kind of, you know, like in terms of social media. So I think they are very agile with it. They're very quick with it. And that is something I would love to learn more on it. And I think this is, and of course, the way the energy levels, the creative thinking, the fresh minds have, I think this is brilliant. And this, I think, definitely, there is some alignment, which obviously the leadership brings in along with the millennials and Gen Z.
Thanks. Interesting. So your company, when I talk to people about your company, in some reference, it could be friends, colleagues, they refer to it as SPAG. And I know how particular you and your colleagues are to not call it SPAG. So for those watching it, the company is SPAG, not SPAG. And my next question is, it's a five-year-old company and you've done so much in the last half decade, winning awards, winning clients, hiring smart people. What is the vision, or where do you see SPAG in the next 5 years? Give us some idea about where the company is headed to in 2026.
SPAG started, of course, it was a startup focusing healthcare communications based out of only India. And I think in 6 years, it's not 5 years, 6 years now. So in a span of 6 years, from a startup to a multinational. So, you know, we have offices in Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines. So technically, yes, we are a multinational, and which is, I think, big achievement. Healthcare definitely remains our core. But apart from that, we have stepped into, you know, healthcare and medtech definitely has been there. But apart from that, we have stepped into technology. We have stepped into startups. We have stepped into, and social impact has always been there. Consumer sector. And yes, there are a lot of objectives we have planned for different, you know, to be present in different parts of Southeast Asia. APAC basically also. So that's 2026. Yes, so there's more to do and a lot of things in pipeline, and hope to reveal that soon.
Right, you have a second brand which you call DYE in short, the Yellow Elephant. Tell us about that as well, Shivani.
So DYE is a digital sister concern of SPAG. So the group company strategic partners room, SPAG is the PR, public affairs and advocacy firm. And DYE is the digital arm, which is digital, social media and creatives. So we have a separate team based out of Mumbai and Delhi, and a couple of very interesting clients and very interesting work that we are doing. It is, a lot of creative work, a lot of video work. We also have a video studio, visual work, and a lot of social media work. And of course, website development is another part of it. So yeah, so that's the digital, another digital thing that we are planning to get into.
Thanks. Helpful to know these things. My last question before we move to the rapid fire round is something I mentioned I would ask you a few moments ago. A lot of youngsters planning to make their careers in public relations and specifically in the healthcare communication space. What is your message? If you had two or three things you want to share with these young people in their early 20s, what would your message be to them to succeed, to thrive, to be amazing professionals in the world of public relations and specifically healthcare communications?
Okay, couple of things. Of course, I think, like I said earlier, millennials and Gen Z and the young leaders who are already there in the space, you know, the public relations space, PR and communication space, they are quite energetic, very creative, very agile, very passionate, and really with a lot of zeal. You know, what I think I would just kind of suggest is that in terms, because there is so much of energy to do, it's important to channelize it. It's as important to prioritize things. I know, we all know that you really want to do lots, you know, but yes, and you will be able to do lots. But most important thing, I think once you start prioritizing things, things just happen on its own. And you will be able to do many things, not just, you know, stuck up at one place. So that is something which I would suggest everyone to do. And that definitely helps you structure your career, structure your day, structure your work. It definitely is, helps you build more productivity.
Right. No, thanks for that. That's helpful. And I hope people of all ages watching this gain inspiration from these insights. With this, we come to the final part of this interview, which is the rapid fire round, which we do with all our guests. Same questions, but different answers each time. 10 questions in less than 90 seconds for you to answer. You can't give us long answers, 3 or 4 words at the most per answer. You have 3 seconds to think and then answer as well. I'll dive straight in. The first one in the 10 question rapid fire, what's the brand you trust the most?
I think, okay, that's not a long answer, but yeah, I think all the new brands that are coming up, which are like focus again on like health and...
One brand you trust the most.
Okay, the older one, I would say Tata is something that I have always trusted.
What is your all-time favorite book?
Becoming by Michelle Obama, which I finished reading sometime back. Yeah.
Okay. You can choose to keep SPG out of this next question as the answer. Which is the best organization you've worked for so far? You work with 2 or 3 prior to SPAG. SPAG may be up about there, but other than SPAG, the best company you've worked for?
Okay, DIY.
Okay. The best boss you ever had in your pre-founder days?
Okay, so my first boss has been Aman Gupta. And obviously, yeah. So officially, yes, after my... finishing my post-graduation, my first boss has been Aman. So obviously I learned a lot, and I think a lot of leadership skills that I picked up was from him.
Interesting. Who's your one professional role model other than Aman Gupta? I don't want that as the answer, please. If there is one other. It can be anybody.
Indra Nooyi is someone who I really like listening to, and obviously, you know, kind of keep a tap on what's happening where. So that is one person. And of course, if you talk about from US, so I worked for some time with Florence Quinn of Quinn Partners out of, from New York. I think she's another lady that I really look up. Yeah.
Thanks. Is there an Indian communicator you admire? If so, who that is? If not, think of one and tell us.
Aman Gupta.
Wow. Are you going to have Aman as your answer for many other questions? Second, okay, who's the second Indian communicator you admire beyond Aman Gupta?
Okay, Amit Prabhu. You have been.
That's not true. Anyway, I'll take that to save time. The next rapid fire question is, name one campaign that you did not work on, but you admire and stands out for you. Not a campaign that you worked on. Any campaign globally or in India that stood out for you. A PR campaign, a communications campaign.
That I did not work on, you're saying.
Correct.
Okay, so I think Dettol has done some good job. I have seen a lot of their campaigns, and I like the way they have kind of built up stories and done a lot of... that is one campaign. And of course, No Tobacco campaigns is something that I had not directly worked, but I had seen what kind of work at the back end happened. So,
I'm sure you take time off with family to unwind, take a break. You have many favorite holiday destinations across the world. Name your one preferred holiday destination. If the lockdown were to end and you had to go for one holiday for a week, where would that be?
Right now, anywhere.
One place that is your favorite holiday destination.
I would want to go to US now. Honestly, not because of any other reason. Because of... I think Kasauli is something that I like going to.
I brought you back from Himachal. Describe Shivani Gupta in 3 words.
that's again difficult. Okay, I'm okay. Complex yet simple.
That's it. Three words. Complex yet simple. Fine. One learning for you in the last 12 months of the lockdown and the life you have all led sitting at home. What's that one learning for you from the last 12 months?
I think it's go with the flow.
Great. Thank you so much, Shivani. It was great talking to you. And I think we learned so much about your career, your life in the last 20, 25 minutes. I hope you enjoyed this interaction as much as I did and the team did putting it together. We look forward to meeting you face to face in the future. This is being done remotely. Thank you for your time and all the best for the next few years of the growth of SPAG, the Yellow Elephant and other things you'll add to the portfolio of companies. For those watching, that's Shivani Gupta from SPAG. Look her up online to get inspired of the various things she does. Thank you so much and see you at the next episode a week from now. All the best.
Thank you so much. Thank you.